So far, we've been assuming that all benefits and costs associated with the consumption and the production of goods and services exchanged in markets accrue to participants, either producers or consumers in those markets. But that, you know, sometimes that's sort of true or mostly true, but very often in our economy, we have benefits and costs that accrue to people that don't participate directly in that market, at least not in the degree to which they bear the costs or enjoy the benefits. And when that's true, we have an externality issue. Externality refers to the fact that benefits and costs are important benefits and costs are external to the market. These effects can be negative or positive, and either one, if there are important externalities, our conclusion that competitive markets lead to the highest level of total surplus or you know, the economically efficient outcome in market activity, those conclusions are just wrong. So here I have a picture of a beekeeper in an urban area. That is Frank's example of a negative externality. I have a lot of friends that are beekeepers, and I know that they would tell me and tell you that bees, especially those honeybees going about their business, do not sting people very, very often. And so they would, I'm sure, talk to us for hours about how bad of an example that is. But anyway, let's just go with it. Let's suppose that, you know, beekeeping brings money to the beekeeper when he or she sells the honey in the marketplace. That transaction, selling the honey in the marketplace, and whatever cost the beekeeper faces maintaining the hives, doing whatever you need to do to beekeep, I really don't know. Those are all internal, but if these bees go around and in the course of their business sting a lot of people, well, those people would likely not be compensated by the beekeeper. I'm doubtful that such arrangements would easily be made. And so those people that get stung more because there's beekeepers around are paying some of the costs associated with producing that honey, and those costs are external to the market. So negative externalities are external costs borne by people outside the market. Now, Frank also uses the beekeeping example, and this is the beauty of this example, is depending on where it takes place, it either results in negative externalities or positive externalities. In Frank's world, Frank's a city guy like most of us. I happen to have some experience working on farms. I'm going to tell you a little story here in a moment. But anyway, let's say that beekeepers are not compensated for having their bees located in orchards. And bees, I think everybody now knows that bees flying around really facilitate the pollination of many, many crops, vegetables, fruit, etc. As the bees go blossom to blossom, they get the pollen stuck on the hairs of their feet, and it turns out there's male and female trees, and by bringing the pollen from one to the other, they end up really quite dramatically increasing the pollination rate. My father made a pile of money from computers in the early 80s and then retired in the mid 80s and went into farming. He grew up in Chicago, but he had relatives in Wisconsin and Minnesota and had really a romantic vision of farming. Anyway, he developed rice land and orchard land in Northern California. And anyway, in those days, the beekeepers would come by and ask, "Hey, can we leave our bee boxes on your property?" And a lot of farmers at that time hadn't really been familiar with the research about the correlation between having bees around and the increase in the pollination rates. Anyway, my dad was like, "Yeah, sure, what the heck?" And not being a lifelong farmer, he was open to just about anything, and he'd try anything. Anyway, back then, you know, he would do that as a favor to the beekeepers, just out of goodwill. But and they'd give him maybe a jar of honey or something like that. But interestingly, as the knowledge about how helpful bees were to facilitating crop pollination, as that knowledge diffused in the intervening years, I'm still in touch with the ranch manager. He's a good friend. Now the beekeepers are able to charge orchard owners quite a bit of money for the privilege of having the bees on their property. So this is a good example of what had been an external benefit, a positive externality. Now that benefit that had formerly been external to the market transaction between beekeepers and the customers for their honey, that's been internalized. Now beekeepers are able to bring their hives to the orchard that's willing to pay them the most money, and there's a well-established market for that. But anyway, Frank doesn't know any better, and let's just pretend like there's no such market in existence, and this is a positive externality. If that's the case, these benefits would accrue to the orchard owners, and even though they weren't directly participating in the honey market. Well, there's all sorts of positive externalities and negative externalities, and I just wanted to give you just a few examples and encourage you to think of your own. So I've created this grid here, and what I'd like you to do is create a similar one in your notes. And just think of some examples. Once you get going, there are just a zillion of them. Let's take negative externalities of production and the easy low hanging fruit to pick up on our orchard example in the previous slide. Coal fired electricity plants. And there's, of course, coal is dirty and filthy to extract, but it's really just a very pollutive activity. So when you burn coal to make electricity, not only is there a lot of local pollution, those are pollutants that come out of the air in the immediate vicinity of the plant. Mercury is one. There's a lot of other ones. There's also regional pollutants, sulfur dioxide and others. There's also, of course, global pollutants. The coal-fired power plants contribute a lot of greenhouse gases to the atmosphere, and those, of course, are related to 97% of climatologists have been convinced that these are contributors to the climate change that we're observing and it's forecast to get worse and worse over the coming decades. Anyway, so you can get going on pollutive activities related to producers. There's quite a long list to think of there. Just thinking about negative externalities, the consumption of alcohol is an activity that results in negative externalities of many types. Probably the most obvious one, when someone decides to go to a bar and drink, if they're just sort of keeping to themselves, they're in the bar, they're paying their money, they're walking home, there's no externality there. But let's say that person drinks a few beers or whiskeys or whatever they like, and then gets in the car. Well, now they're operating a vehicle under the influence, and their risk of accident is much, much greater. And maybe they wrap their own car around a tree and kill themselves. There's no externality there, but it's a very common tale that the drunk driver takes out a pedestrian or hits a car full of other people and injures them. These are external costs associated with the consumption of alcohol. On a less dramatic level, alcohol. A lot of parties feature the consumption of alcohol. That's true. For me, that started in high school, went through college, and for a lot of us, a beer or two maybe sort of loosens us up and makes us better company. Maybe not, but that's the idea anyway. Well, three or four, and now instead of just being a little more free about talking to people of interest to you, now you're just sort of loud and obnoxious, you're the jerk at the party, and all the people that have to put up with you, they're bearing some of the costs associated with that market transaction between whoever bought the keg for the party and whoever sold it to them. Positive externalities, there's plenty of those. Let's just talk about positive externalities related to consumption. When I've just spent all day doing yard work, but let's say I hired out some landscaping services. I tend to be a cheapskate and do this kind of stuff myself. I painted my own house some years ago, and now I'm trying to fix up my own yard. Anyway, when I consume landscaping services, I am paying a landscaper to come and improve my property, put in new plantings, trim up what I have, you know, remove the weeds, etc. That's a market transaction, and you know, the benefits and costs fall on me and on the person providing the service and whoever he or she buys their supplies from, etc. But the fact is, when I fix up my property, I'll get some of those benefits. I get to live there and enjoy the view. If I sell the house, it's better if it looks nice inside and out. But the fact is, a huge portion of the benefits of the landscaping fall on my neighbors who used to look at my weedy, overgrown, you know, junk car ridden lot, and now I've spruced it up and I've got a nice lawn and beautiful native plants and everything's just so. And you know, suddenly it's a pleasant view. Not only do they get to enjoy that pleasant view, if they sell their properties, their property values will go up mightily. Now finally, and then again, you go wild on your own examples, but another example of a positive externality, this time related to production. One of the activities in an economy that has the most positive spillovers is research and development expenditure on the part of pharmaceutical firms, technology firms, etc. And there's an interesting thing about knowledge is when a firm invests money in discovering new knowledge, that knowledge is really hard to contain inside that firm. Knowledge is really what we call leaky. There's a lot of positive spillover. So my favorite example come from my brother's industry that was an industry I was on track to go into back when I was your age, when I was an undergraduate. I was a CS major to start. Anyway, the software programmers, there's a reason why a lot of companies locate in Silicon Valley. All these programmers, they all went to school together, they go to lunch together, and if you've ever been part of their conversation, they are just all bragging to one another about how they solve various coding problems. Well, guess what? You know, I'm struggling with my own coding problem. I go to lunch with my friend who's over at a different company, and he's telling me how he handled a similar problem. Guess what? Now it's easier for me to go back to my workplace and fix that same problem. And these examples just abound. Also, I work for one company, we do a lot of coding, and you know, I decide to get up and go. Well, that company that I used to work for can't keep what's now inside my brain. That leaves with me when I go to another firm. And this is really actually a beautiful thing in a knowledge economy, that there's tremendous positive externalities that travel from one firm to another. We'll leave this overview at that.
Made with DoodleCast Pro.